Good morning, Wisconsin. Morning, world. It's a new day. Thanks for kicking it off with us right here at WFHR. Got your host, James J., joined by, of course, our head of news, our co-host, Melissa Kaye.
Good morning.
Our head of production, our co-host, Seth Habhegger.
Good morning.
Let me double check. Yep, best listeners in radio here. All right, we can start the week. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Good things coming up for you throughout the show. Let's kick things off the way we like to with our good friend, Brittany Merlot, talking little Mother Nature. Good morning, Brett.
Good morning. Happy Monday to you.
Good morning to you, Brittany. I'm going to do a bad British accent right now because it's a bad bloody London weather.
Oh,
London
fog sure looks like it,
today,
yeah.
And that's tradition right there. It was a reach joke. I had to reach for that one, I did.
It was a good one. I'm plotting you over here.
I really don't know if you should, Britt. I don't know.
I am. Got me laughing on a Monday. That's hard to do, okay?
Well, especially with this weather we've got this morning. I'm trying to cheer things up, get things moving a little bit more.
Seriously, I know. Ick. I don't know about you guys, but it is foggy, dreary, misty, nasty here in Wausau, and it looks like we got a little wintry mix headed our way over the next few hours. So temperatures are actually taking a little dip. They're going to hover right around those low 30s before they rise a little bit later on today. So what's going to happen is this rain could flip over to quick accumulating shot of some snowfall, maybe about a half an inch we're looking at, before it leaves by the afternoon. So this is very quick and probably while everyone's at work and hopefully where you're going to be for the day. So no big problems because rush hour later on, it'll be gone and out of here. But temperatures, like I said, were dropping. By tonight, we fall to the teens, and for the rest of the week, we don't get above freezing. Not for our highs, definitely not for our lows.
All right. We'll take it. We'll take it.
Okay, not like we have a choice.
A brighter day tomorrow.
Yes. There we go.
We'll take the sun.
Nicely done, Brittany. Yeah. Nice today. Wrap on a good note. We appreciate you, Britt. Hope you had a great weekend. Looking forward to hanging out on this short week together.
Yes, sounds good. Can't wait. Have a good day, guys.
You too.
Bye, Brittany.
Best in the business right there from Brittany Merlot joins us every morning right here in this time slot. We got good things coming up for you, everybody. In a little bit, we're going to talk about, was your weekend fast? Well, maybe it'll help if we name it something different. We got that coming up. And we're going to be talking turkey a lot this week. How many calories will the average American eat on Thanksgiving?
Of course.
What Americans plan to eat for Thanksgiving? We've got that coming up as well. And we'll get into some other fun stuff. It's a Monday, and the 9 o'clock hour, you know how that kicks off with the kitchens open. Beth Habhegger will be joining us a little bit later for that. Looking forward to it. Also got some entertainment news for you. We say goodbye to a game show legend. We're going to be talking to the director. We're not going to be talking to the director of Wicked. We're going to hear from the director of Wicked.
Oh, there we go. Okay.
That sounded a little bit bigger than it meant to be.
Whoa. That's a get.
Well, I didn't tell you guys. I just landed on the director.
Yeah.
We got local theater to talk about, and we got a big local event going on this Wednesday we got to talk about as well. We get build up and get ready for Rekindle the Spirit, everybody.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And as long as we're talking, entertainment and all that, I want to get into which celebrities would you invite over for Thanksgiving? Which celebrities you would, and I want audience participation. You guys got some time here. Go ahead and think about who's a celebrity you would invite over. I'm thinking Martha Stewart. People.
Only if Snoop comes.
Yes. Oh, yeah, yeah, definitely.
Oh, yeah, they're a pair now, right? Yeah, I mean, yeah. One and the other one.
Yeah, absolutely. Different celebrities. We'll be getting into that.
Celebrity is still the same. I'll save it till then.
Hoping it would be. Good, good. All that coming up. But right now, let's kick off things. Ooh, right about here, because if you dislike mornings, everybody, maybe this is an interesting hack or maybe not. A self-help guru named, that is one of those phrases.
Self-help guru.
I'm sure that there are good people out there doing very good work and helping a lot of people,
also snake charmers.
Yeah, because
snake oil peddlers.
I can't say that phrase and not picture the 1920s Dust Bowl snake oil salesman running around. Yeah. I'd like to help you. I got this great bottle of self-help.
It'll fix everything.
It'll fix all of it. It'll take care of your joints and make you feel better. Here's some snake oil.
It's straight whiskey.
Well, self-help guru Mel Robbins is going viral after telling people to try slithering out of bed. She did it for 6 weeks and claims it's life-changing for people who wake up with a sense of dread. The name sums it up pretty well, but she posted a video of exactly how to do it, just in case nobody played a snake when they were kids.
In case it wasn't clear.
Right, oh my gosh. Slowly slide out of the bed and onto the floor. Lie there for a few minutes if you need to.
I'm dying.
Then
you broke Melissa. My gosh.
It gets better, Mel. Then you literally crawl to the bathroom. She claims you'll feel much better about your day by the time you get there and stand up.
Yes, start from bottom. You know, just start on the floor. It's gotta get better after that.
Yeah, exactly. Nowhere to go but up.
If you got aches and pains, man, you're gonna feel a little bit better just standing up, I suppose. Yeah. Some people say it's worked for them, and others think it's just new age nonsense. The best comment was someone who said they tried it but woke up on the floor 2 hours later.
Oh my!
Just a different place to sleep. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
it was comfy.
Yeah. I never noticed how comfy my floor was.
Here's what I will say. I think the reason that people are finding that this makes them feel better is because a lot of people don't stretch when they get up in the morning.
Mm.
And this forces you to actually move your body in different ways than you normally do.
So
therefore, you're like stretching parts of your body. And to get up off of the floor requires you to use a different set of muscles than you do just sitting up and getting out of bed.
Great point. Great point.
I love Melissa's actually trying to do the good points on this. That's good. I appreciate her doing that.
Because I feel like that's usually my role, and I like that you took that route. I like you did. What about other animals? Maybe trying other animals. Maybe that's the way to go.
Well, personally, I like to do the kangaroo in the morning.
You know, yes.
Jump to the bathroom.
It's a great way to do it.
With my hands
this. If you do the dog all night long, then you're in better shape because dogs like get up and they turn around.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And then they lay back down. There was a trend for a little while saying that was how you get better sleep. Get up and run around your bed every half hour in the middle of the night and then you'll sleep better. Which is total bull hockey.
James should try this, he's the one that's up every half hour at night. I'm going to try every animal.
Anything, that's right.
You know, a penguin, I flop out of bed and I waddle to the bathroom,
Tie your knees together and see how it works.
I'll be a raccoon, I'm just looking for like debris and things to chew, you know.
Digging through every trash can on the way.
Wash your hands five times.
I like this. If anything, maybe what I'd like to have happen here is somebody who lives with somebody else and they sleep in the same bed, but you don't tell your partner you're doing this. You just do it. You just go ahead.
Just flop out of bed.
Slide out of bed.
What are you doing?
Yeah, just see how long you can do this. If anything, I mean, I got to think that that's, whether this works or not, it makes you more energized or anything, it's going to give you a laugh. I got to think. It's going to make you laugh a little bit.
Someone will get a laugh out of it. Yeah.
I want to see the spider.
Oh, there you go.
Climb the walls on your way to the bathroom.
I like that.
The other thing, I can guarantee one thing. If you're going to do this on a regular basis, you are going to be very good about cleaning your floors.
Because
if you're going to be slithering across the floor, man, you want it to be clean.
Either that or you just have to wear a different pair of pajamas every single night because they will be cleaning the floor.
Oh, see, I was looking at it the wrong way. They're actually cleaning their floors. That's what it is.
It's multi-purpose.
There you go.
This was all designed to just get your floors cleaner. This has very little to do with it. It's going to be a big reveal.
Ha-ha, suckers.
Gotcha. A former patron of a Pennsylvania library returned a book recently that had been due back 51 years ago.
All right.
In the book was Lombardi, Winning is the Only Thing, edited by Jerry Kramer. A lot of local ties there.
Yeah, played for Vince Lombardi, yeah.
This was due back on July 26th in 1973 and was returned to the Benson Memorial Library in Tuttsville 51 years later.
They finally finished it.
Yeah. It's a reader. It takes a while. You know, you want to take your time with that
They were so distraught by Vince not being the Packer coach anymore, they just had to keep it, you know.
Well, maybe they weren't winning
Living
yet.
In the past.
Yep.
Maybe they hadn't started winning, you know. I mean, if you're not, you just keep reading the book until, one of these days I got to start winning.
Right. They just this year started watching football again. They were so distraught.
maybe you just didn't feel like you read it right. You know?
Yeah.
I'm not winning enough in life. Wait a minute.
He's not the coach of the Packers anymore? What?
And if you are keeping a library book overdue, I feel like that's really going against. That's kind of like having a book checked out for too long. How to return a library book.
Yeah, right.
Cliff Notes version.
Yeah. There you go.
This is too long of a read.
Yeah. Forget it.
We'll come back with the El Cafe Birthday and Anniversary Club here on The Morning Show at WFHR. It's time to do some celebrating with our great friends over at El Cafe and the Birthday and Anniversary Club. We encourage you to treat yourself tomorrow. Get on over to El Cafe when they open their doors tomorrow at 221 Market Avenue in beautiful Port Edwards.
Yes, they're always closed on Mondays.
They are.
Yeah, they sure are. Make sure to mark your calendars for tomorrow. Get over there, everybody, and enjoy. And they got some great specials coming up for you, everyone. Be ready for those.
Love it.
But there's nothing wrong you can order over there, really.
Nope.
A single thing.
Nope.
I had a delicious Reuben last week. Ooh. It was so good.
First time
I've had a Reuben there.
My dad's a big fan of those. We're going to have to take him over there.
It's kind of my go-to sandwich.
Really?
His too. Actually, the way I am with bacon cheeseburgers, where I like to go everywhere and try one, he's that way with Reuben's. So he hasn't been to El Cafe. I got to get him over there.
Yeah. It's a lot easier to mess up a Reuben, I got to say. So when you find a good one, go for it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they get them good.
Find out more of your new favorite over at El Cafe, everybody, at 221 Market Avenue in beautiful Port Edwards. And buy local support those that support this community, everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Get us those birthdays and anniversaries. We want to celebrate with you. info@WFHR.com. You can email us that way. You can direct message us on our Facebook pages, of course. And you can, of course, call up.
That's right, 715-424-2600. Call up and wish your happy birthday or anniversary with us.
Looking forward to hanging out with you, everybody. Give us a call. We have two possible qualifiers here. Seth, give me a one or a two.
Yeah, one today.
All right, gives us that qualifier. We can get right into the celebrating. First up, wishing happy birthday to Tia Smith.
Happy birthday, Tia.
Happy birthday.
It's a great name, Tia. It's a good name. Enjoy your day, Tia. Hope it's a good one for you. We wish a very happy birthday to our qualifier, Jack Fayville.
Happy birthday, Jack.
Happy birthday, Jack.
That name may be familiar to quite a bit. I guarantee it's familiar to quite a bit of the community. Jack, of course, been on the air with us a number of times. Mm. Jack and Connie, of course, creators and supporters of the FRM music, Friends of Rapids Music and everything. And Jack, one of my favorite people to be on stage with, even though it's only happened a couple of times. But
cool.
MCing for FRM and being out there when Jack was already out there, getting ready to go out there, couldn't have a better backstage energy. Just a great energy backstage, and just a kind of, hey, we're going to do it, the same energy off stage, on stage. It's so rare, I think, when you see that. Mm-hmm. A fantastic musician as well.
Very cool.
Goats and Trees and so many other great bands that him and Connie. And,
still one of the greatest band names ever.
Yes, it is. Goats and Trees. That's awesome band name.
Jack, we encourage you to brag and tell everybody that you're a qualifier today. Congratulations. We take a look at our celebrity list, and I say the celebrity very, lightly here with this one. Joey Chestnut is 41, hot dog eating champion who set the world record when he shoved 75 dogs down his throat. Congratulations.
Yeah.
I could not have less interest in these people. I'm sorry.
Well, that is what they do.
Yeah, I know it is. It's so weird, and it's wrong, and it's, I don't know. With a name like Chestnut, he should have done something cooler than that. Come on, Jimmy.
Complete. Well, if you're going to eat, be the world record holder of chestnuts.
Chestnuts,
you messed this up, man.
That sounds awful. All of it sounds awful. Massive amounts of anything is a bad idea, but chestnuts would be probably really bad.
So what are eating contests for then? I don't understand. So many people I know are like, ew, those are gross. They don't like them. So what? I know, there's got to be.
I don't get it.
I don't know if you guys have seen any of those reels, but I think it's pretty big in Asian countries.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, for whatever reason.
Yeah.
Right. Cramming food in their face, yeah. mouth as fast as they can. It just, it's weird. It's a little weird to me. But
it's a little odd.
Their own.
Yeah.
Their own.
I completely understand how some people don't understand sports. That I get completely. This is my one with that. Yes. This is my one. Like, I've never been able to wrap my mind around why, if it's a county fair pumpkin pie eating contest or it's something like this, what people get out of it. I couldn't think of less entertaining that.
Yeah.
At the Central Wisconsin State Fair, Melissa suggested to me, hey, you got to see the pig races over there before you go and everything. And I'm so glad she did. It was awesome. It was really cool. I've never seen anything like that before. I sat there. I was actually late for my appointment later that day because I was there for a little while. I watched two races. I would rather sit there and watch that for the whole day than watch 5 seconds of somebody trying to devour food. Like that, those pigs were hustling, man. Those pigs were racing.
They are pretty cute.
That was a sport. They were racing each other. That the eating thing.
But it causes me physical pain to watch it because I know if I ate anything that fast, I would actually be in pain.
Right.
Because my body doesn't tolerate it well. Mm-hmm. I eat. I am a pretty slow eater.
Right.
But. No thanks.
Joel Kinnaman is 45. RoboCop, AMC's The Killing, Rick Flagg in The Suicide Squad. Fantastic character actor. One of my favorites. You see Joel Kinnaman a part of a movie, everybody, you can almost guarantee it's going to be a good script.
Nice.
He picks Swedish good actor. Stuff. Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Interesting.
Oh, you know, the first picture that popped up of him, he'd make a great James Bond. Like old school looking James Bond.
Yeah. Cool. Swedish James Bond. Oh, yeah.
Hey.
There's not much I don't think that guy can do. He's great. Really good actor.
And he's 45. He could totally still do it.
Yeah.
Come on. Cast him.
Donovan McNabb is 48, longtime Philadelphia Phillies quarterback, now an analyst for the NFL Network.
Mm-hmm. Very good quarterback.
The wonderful, the great, the amazing Christina Applegate is 53 today. Many will remember her as Kelly Bundy in Married with Children. She was Debbie in Vacation, Veronica Cornerstone in the Anchorman movies, and a strong breast cancer survivor. Really, I would say that this second half of her life has really been, or third act, really, because she kind of came back after Married with Children after being typecasted for so long with the Anchorman role and some of those things. But she's really put her focus on cancer awareness about people being checked and sharing her story. I really, really like her, but I really admire her as a person. I think Christina Applegate, I've said this many times, you don't see smart actors playing stupid. You can't.
Right.
There's no way to play that character, play a silly character, a dumb character, quote unquote dumb character, like a Peggy Bundy or somebody, or a Kelly Bundy.
Yeah.
Without being actually intelligent.
Right. Exactly.
Woody Harrelson, the same thing with in Cheers. Mm-hmm. These kind of Dick Van Patten. And Coach.
Yep.
These are good examples of people that can do that and that are incredibly intelligent people. She's a really good actress and really got typecast, and so much of her career got thrown to the side because she wasn't willing to play Kelly Bundy in every role.
Right.
And that's a shame because we lost out. She didn't. She did to a degree, certainly, but really her fans really lost out. Great actor, and very happy that she is still with us. The Green-Eyed Bandit, Eric Sermon, is 56 of EPMD. Nobody out there knows what I'm talking about, but I wanted to say the Green-Eyed Bandit because that is a great nickname. If you're a rapper and you go by the Green-Eyed Bandit, that's pretty good.
That's not bad.
Bernie Kosar, 61, Cleveland Browns quarterback and legend.
Oh, good old Bernie.
And what I thought was the only good Jewish football player at the time. It was the hair.
It was the hair.
I thought he was one of the jokes.
The ugliest throwing motion of quarterback history. Oh, my God. But it worked. Man, he was good.
Amy Grant is 64. Grammy winner.
Really?
And married with Vince Gill.
That's right.
One of my first CDs.
It was an Amy Grant one? Really?
Yeah. Well, because she was a Christian singer,
yes,
so I was allowed to have that at that time.
Years ago, I had to look into this because I wanted to see what happened here with this. Because a lot of times, if a pop artist is their career's dying or something like that, they'll go to a different genre. And a lot of times, they do go to Christian music because there is this idea that, oh, I can make it easier in that genre, or I can get a diamond-selling record in there.
Right.
A lot of people don't realize that Christian records are actually very different. They don't keep keep the same, accomplishments as, you know, hey, I got a platinum selling record. They got different names for them over there.
Yeah.
And it's actually a very, very cutthroat industry, like a very cutthroat industry, like all music.
Yeah. And it's an industry, right?
I mean, guarantee you the polka industry is tense. Like, there's no music genre.
Tim on here and asking.
You're talking about creatives and artists, and there's, yeah, for every artist that makes it, there is, yep, 1,000 artists right behind them, whether we're talking about mimes or actors, mm-hmm, or whatever we're talking about.
Man, but Amy Grant was such an interesting story. I mean, she started out in Christian music, and then all of a sudden she exploded in pop music in the 90s, which was very rare at the time. And then when that kind of petered out, she kind of went back to Christian music again. Mm-hmm. So,
well, and she could have.
She has a really pretty Christmas song that I wouldn't mind promoting called Breath of Heaven.
Yes.
It's also known as Mary's Song. It's, yep, really pretty.
Mary's Song. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's how I knew it. It's Mary's Song. Yep. Yeah, yeah. That is a good song. Yeah.
It's a very pretty Christmas song. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
When you get that break in pop, most people stay there. Mm-hmm. And she didn't. She seemed to get what she needed from it and then move on.
Yep.
I've always admired that. Yep. And a great singer and songwriter. Great,
yeah,
singer.
She's written some really good songs.
Mm-hmm. My third or maybe my second favorite TV lawyer of all time, John Larroquette, is 77 today. Night Court superstar. Dan Fielding on Night Court. Great actor.
I love John Larroquette.
Let's see here. Percy Sledge would have been celebrating a birthday today, born in 1940. When a Man Loves a Woman, of course.
Oh, great soul singer.
Excuse me for a second. Con!
Ooh.
Ricardo Montalban, born on this day. Khan from the Star Trek show.
Yes.
Movies and all that show.
He was in the show first, and then he was in the movie. Yeah, you weren't wrong, man.
Most famous, of course, is Mr. Rourke in Fantasy Island.
Mm-hmm.
And the grandfather in the Spy Kid movies and everything.
Oh, I've forgotten about that. Plus, he was in a gajillion ads.
Fine.
For so many things.
Fine Corinthian
leather.
I only know what Corinthian is because of
Ricardo Montalban, yes.
Great actor, great voice.
I love his voice.
Oh,
and that accent,
voice.
Man.
Yes.
Ah, love it.
Joe DiMaggio, born in this day in 1914, passed away in 1999, baseball legend.
Jolton Joe.
So we're going to be talking about him on Playmakers today, later today.
The Yankee Clipper. Man, he had some really cool nicknames, too, by the way.
Yeah, he did. And a couple more, like John F. Kennedy Sr., former president, born on this day. Born in 1960, not former president, but the son of the former president.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Born in 1960, passed away in 1999. Mm-hmm. Grandson, maybe, actually.
Yeah, it was his son.
And Andrew Carnegie, born in this day in 1835, passed away in 1919. Mm. Grew up in poverty, started working at the age of 12 for a dollar a day. At his peak, he was worth over $300 million in 1901.
In 1901.
Yeah. That's a lot of money.
And in his last 18, 20 years of his life, pretty much gave it all away.
Mm-hmm. Carnegie Libraries.
Yeah. Yep.
There's so many communities still in across the United States that still have those buildings or are still an active library, the Carnegie Libraries. Yep.
I do this with music or entertainment a lot of the times. I don't know if I'm right about this. I'm saying this, asking this question, not even rhetorically. I'm asking, can you tell the history of America without the Andrew Carnegie?
Probably not.
No.
It was very important.
Yeah.
Sure.
Founding U.S. Steel. Yeah.
Empire. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Participation in the Industrial Revolution.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we wouldn't have the machinery and the transportation without the steel industry.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Agreed. I think if I could just piggyback on that, his story is such the American story as well, of coming from nothing and making it.
Mm-hmm.
That's so much. The American story isn't, when I was 18, my daddy gave me $1 million and I went bankrupt 5 times. Like, that's not the American dream. Like, the American dream is, you come from nothing, you make it, and then you help others.
Then you give it back.
You're supposed to do good. You're supposed to, all the creatives I look up to, all the actual really businessmen or anybody like that, all have the same kind of plan. I get up there and then I let the ladder down so that others can climb up.
Mm.
That's the way it's done. That's to me, that's the mm-hmm. American dream. That's part of the American dream. Not just, hey, I come from nothing, I make it. It's what do I do once I make it?
Right.
And Andrew Carnegie seemed to get that.
And his story is, I mean, just like any other story, ups and downs, good, bad,
all kinds
of things. It's just a really interesting American story. It really is.
Yeah. And I guess I think it's so much in nowadays when we're talking about the these individuals. You know, each one of them, Joe DiMaggio, John F. Kennedy, Andrew Carnegie, mm-hmm. Percy Sledge, any one of these people, we could spend 5-10 minutes on the negative, on the positive. Sure. I really do encourage people to look at people the way you would want to be looked at,
mm-hmm.
and as a full picture. Yep. As the whole story.
Human being.
Yeah, yeah. One more time, happy birthday to Tia Smith.
Happy birthday, Tia.
And a very happy birthday to our qualifier, Jack Fayville.
Happy birthday, Jack.
Happy birthday, Jack.
Get us more of these birthdays and anniversaries, everybody. We love to celebrate with mm-hmm. you. Keep in mind, we've got a short week this week. So if you got birthdays on Thursday or Friday, try to get them to us early, okay?
Oh, man, mm-hmm. we're going to be doing it for an hour on Wednesday. Oh, my gosh.
Birthday forever.
The whole 8 o'clock hour on Wednesday is just birthdays just and anniversaries. Birthdays and anniversaries. It's just that. You guys actually don't even have to show up if you don't want to.
Yeah, there you go.
And for Thursday, we'll get my voice goes. We'll be back with more show, morning show at WFHR. Welcome back, everybody. Morning show at WFHR. Melissa, Seth, and James hanging out with you. We hope you're having a good one out there. Thanks for joining us, everybody. How was your weekend? How was everybody's weekend? You guys have a good weekend?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. It was pretty good.
Good.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
A good weekend.
Good. Good to hear. Probably went too fast. Probably went pretty quick. I don't remember the last time I had a weekend and I was like, wow, that's over finally. It just doesn't seem to happen.
No.
It depends on if you have to work or if there's obligations.
Yeah, that's for sure.
If it's just
your
weekend, then yeah, no, it always goes too fast.
Well, according to a, quote, happiness expert... Just, how do you get that title?
Yeah, you just call yourself that, you know.
Yes.
I'm a happiness expert.
Shouldn't we? So we've had, for years, we've had the debate and the conversation about you can't give yourself a nickname. We all agree you can't give yourself a nickname unless you're Shaquille O'Neal. Like, that's the
For some
the
reason, he's guy. Allowed, yeah.
It's the only one that's been grandfathered in. It's because none of us want to stand up to him. So, I don't know
can't
why.
Tell
I
don't
know
don't
why.
Do it, Jack.
I don't know what it is. But I feel like we should extend this to you can't give yourself, like, some arbitrary title. You know, I am actually the world's foremost penguin fan. I'm the biggest penguin fan in the world. Like, you can't do that. There's some kid out there who's like 13 or younger.
He knows way more about penguins.
Way more than I do. Yeah. I don't feel like you can do that. According to it, and if you can, you need to be able to back it up. Like what they do to us as entertainers all the time mm-hmm. or comedians I see all the time. Oh, you're a comedian. Tell me a joke. Make me laugh. Yeah. Oh, you're happy. Yeah. Make me happy. Make me happy right now.
Sing something.
Make me happy. Casey Holmes is a happiness researcher who wrote a book called Happier Hour, How to Beat Distraction, Expand Your Time, and Focus on What Matters Most. Her next book might not be as long of a long of a title. Like, how about a short title?
I hope not.
How
yeah.
She ran a study where hundreds of people were told to treat their 2 days off like a mini vacation instead of a weekend.
Hmm.
And just thinking about it, that made a difference. People slept in a little longer, had more fun, and didn't worry about knocking everything off their to-do list and just felt more in the moment.
Hmm.
It might mean you'll have to spend more time knocking those chores out on the weekdays, but she says it's worth having the extra days where you truly get to relax and kick back. Hmm. If your life is too busy to take 2 days completely off, she suggests easing into it, just giving yourself one vacation day, a weekend. Like, take Saturday off and cram all your chores and errands into a Sunday. She also says it's not something you should try to do every weekend. It works best if you do it occasionally, like after a really tough week.
Mm, okay.
Giving yourself a breather. Mm-hmm. That's what mm-hmm. we used to call it in our house.
Yeah, right.
You know, mm-hmm. I don't know how realistic this really is for your families out there. You know, if you're a single parent, like every day is about, you know, keep trying to catch up on
just
yesterday.
Just getting through it.
Yeah. Right. Let alone all the things that you might have missed in days mm-hmm. before or something mm-hmm. like that. Do people out there that work three different jobs, even if you do have a partner at home,
yep.
The energy that you have, you know, especially for me, when I was in that kind of situation, mm-hmm. I'd get home, I had adrenaline, so I'd try to get the laundry done. I'd try to get something done because we had, a billion things to do. Mm-hmm. I I understand the need and how important it is for mental health and all of these things to have breaks. And I am not at all discounting that. And I am the first person to encourage people to have it. But the when people pitch these things, I feel like they are such in a bubble so many times. And I don't know this lady. I don't mm-hmm. know if she is or anything like that. But the way it comes across very... with a lot of privilege.
Right, yeah. You know? That's a good way of putting it, yeah.
It's the person that says that they, I'm boycotting this because I don't believe in this, but because I can afford to go to other things.
Right, exactly.
There's these lines in the sand people want to make, and like, well, not everybody can make that line.
It sounds like she's writing for a specific audience, you know, like the more... I don't even know if upwardly mobile is even a thing anymore. But, you know, people of a certain, you know, maybe income bracket or something like that.
Financially independent.
Yeah, the people that work can, you know, that work normal, you know, regular weekday jobs, you know, 9 to 5 kind of thing. But then have weekends that they don't have to work. And then, yeah, so that's, I'm guessing that's who the they're trying to talk to in this one. Yeah. So, but that's missing a lot of people.
And I don't want to take away from the idea, though. I think the idea is good.
No, I agree with you.
Being able to pull it off might be different. Melissa?
Well, also, she's not suggesting you to do something that costs you any money.
Yes.
That's true. Yeah.
That's true.
I would say that this is far more feasible for a lot more people than, you know, somebody who's like, well, you know, just spend the time planning your next vacation. You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Look ahead to next year when you can take those 2 or 3 weeks off and go tour Italy. Mm. You know, like this is far more achievable for the vast majority of us than, and it's also encouraging you to, you know, like take just a day. Take a day. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Like, do that because you need it.
I tried
to. And folks, I needed this. I did this weekend.
Oh, God.
I still worked for a few hours on Saturday and Sunday, but the vast majority of the weekend, I took off, which is kind of a first for me in many, many, many
Good
months.
For you.
That's many, many months. I saw 3 movies this weekend.
Whoa. Holy cow.
Whoa.
That is a record.
Blown away. I am blown away. Knock me over with a feather.
You should be.
We're both genuinely actually shocked over here. Like, that's awesome, Melissa. That's
so
good
that.
To hear. I'm really proud of you. That's really good to hear, man. That's
and
good.
Well, we have, Melissa, we forgot the other side of this. Maybe if we can convince him to take like one day of quote unquote vacation, maybe James will finally think about taking a real vacation. Can we? Do you think we can ease him into it?
What did you have for breakfast this morning, Seth?
Vacation.
My coffee was really strong.
Apparently, that or you're just like delusional over there. I don't know that that's possible.
Hey, I was just trying to throwing ideas out there. You know,
Maybe James figure something read this out. Book.
Yeah.
Maybe you should read this book.
Vacation, an extended period of leisure and recreation, especially one spent away from home or work. Oh, interesting.
Okay, so now you know what it means. See, first step. Man, right, first
gotcha,
steps.
Gotcha. All right. Yeah, I don't know. It doesn't sound that interesting. It doesn't. I'm not even joking on that. That's me. I vacations don't really sound that interesting to me. But what I try to do with this, and I try to take and give myself an hour. Or an hour or two. I'm so, my life is such my job here at the station. Mm-hmm. I'm here on the air for 4 or 5 hours. Mm-hmm. I'm blocked in on those. And the rest of my day ends up being that way. Oh, I got 3-4 hours for this. Oh, I got 4 or 5 hours for teaching. I got 3 hours to help my folks. Whatever it might be, it's all blocked up in that, in my days. So if I can take a day or a Saturday especially, where, you know what, those 2 hours... Man, I'm going to catch up on that book I've been dying to. Like, I'm finally going to pick up my daughter's book and read some of it or something like that. Mm-hmm. I really try to do those things. How often I pull it off?
That's what I thought.
But for me, it's building to, because look, what do you think the odds are of me taking a 3-day weekend off or a day off? So it's building to that for me because I'm not alone on this. I really felt like I was for a very long time. The more research I've done, there are so many people out there that are obsessed with work, and I don't think the majority of us even realize it. It wasn't until my kids started focusing on me and telling me these things before I realized it. Most of us need that, so I think an ease into that is take a happy hour. I have a happy hour.
There you
man.
Go, a happy hour.
Yeah, you take the hour, like that hour is blocked off. You are going to go ahead and you're going to try to relax. You're going to try to zone down on the TV show or take a nap. I don't know, you know, whatever your thing is.
Just don't do anything. Just psh. Yeah.
And maybe you can build towards that, having the day off or what have you. I do think, too, another thing is that I don't know if she talks about in the book or not. If you can say, okay, this Saturday or this Sunday, I'm taking off. And you can, throughout the week, plan for it better so you don't have mm-hmm. as much laundry waiting for you on Saturday or Sunday or something. Or
especially if that's something like that bothers you. You know, it's like, I need to do this and I need to do this. If you can find a way, like you said, to plan ahead and get it done beforehand, I bet you'll feel a lot better.
Here's one of my biggest problems, and I don't think I'm alone on this one. When I am laying in bed and I can't sleep, or when I am trying to sit back and take that hour off, mm-hmm. what's playing in my head? Oh, all the things that I should be doing. All the things
See, that's
that are
the
waiting
thing you,
for
that's
me.
The thing you got to work on.
And if I'm a single parent or I'm somebody like that taking a day mm-hmm. off, it's hard to imagine them not sitting there worrying about, well, mm-hmm. I was already behind. Now how behind am I going to be? So how much are you really getting of a mental health break if that's what's happening? You've really got to be able to disengage and just kind of engage into nothingness.
Engage into nothingness. Yeah, I like that.
Well, if you don't make yourself do it at some point, you will just shut down.
There's the
And
other
then
part.
Yeah, not that's have true. The choice of not doing nothing because at some point your brain just says, nope, you are done.
Here's the way. Here's a couple. Here's
strong
a,
point.
I got something here that might work for some people out there. Something I like to do is, okay, so I know I want to take a little time for myself to do something, whatever. So I pick one thing that I should do, you know, like dishes
like
or just start laundry. Just do that one thing. And then go and take some time off because it'll always be there. Right? There's always more stuff waiting for you, right? It'll always be there. So it's like, you know, it's okay if I take the time to do this one thing that I want to do. And then I'll come back to it later and it'll still be there. So,
We will take a quick break and we'll come back. We're going to talk some turkey. We're talking Thanksgiving coming up on the morning show here at WFHR. Welcome back, everybody. Morning show here at WFHR. Melissa, Seth, and James here with you, being played in by the silliest named song of all time. It really felt like the Police were just like such good songwriters. They're like, I bet we can make a hit with this just nonsense.
Do, 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 da, da, da.
And it worked.
It worked.
I don't know how high it went on the charts, but it went high
it was
on
a
the
hit,
charts.
Yeah.
It was a hit. It was a hit. We've got a hit coming up this weekend. Of course, we have Rekindle the Spirit. We're going to be talking about that coming up in a little bit. That is showing up on Wednesday.
Yeah.
Looking forward to that. One of our favorite events of the year. Mm-hmm. One of our signature events here in Rapids.
I think so.
That's coming up, and of course Turkey Day, Thanksgiving is right around the corner, so you know we're going to be talking a lot of turkey this week.
Turkey.
No matter how serious you are about your diet, the biggest challenge of the year, most experts will tell you, is Thanksgiving.
Okay.
Even bigger than Christmas, Thanksgiving is the one that can really just throw a monkey wrench into that diet. A new report looked at how many calories people are downing at the Thanksgiving table.
Ooh, that was a slip there. drowning in.
Yeah, every once in a while, dyslexia actually leads. It's so bad. It's
brilliant.
And there's good news and bad news. The average American calorie intake during the Thanksgiving meal is just, quote unquote, just 2,092 calories.
Wow.
Which doesn't seem that bad. According to a dietary guidelines in the U.S., adults should consume anywhere between 1,600 and 3,000 calories per day, depending on a bunch of stuff like age, weight, and gender. Of course, that's the whole day, so the Thanksgiving number is only in range if it's your only meal that day.
Right.
Which isn't something you should do.
No. Some people aren't kidding themselves. This year, 14% of people are planning to eat over 3,000 calories, and 4% are planning to eat over 5,000 calories.
Whoa.
And Thursday isn't the end of it. The average person will also be eating about 2,270 calories worth of leftovers.
Ooh.
Nearly 40% of people said that they will eat more than that. And 27% said 3,000 calories in leftovers, while 9% said 5,000.
How do they know? That seems fine. That's a lot.
You chart it out. You make a chart, man. And you put it all in there, and you got to fill. You got to hit that number, Seth.
Challenge. Are they goals? Is that what this is? I'm gonna hit 5,000 this year. Yeah.
Certainly, a lot of workout people have have a goal for how many calories to take in a day.
Especially if you're bulking up. You know,
I was told by a couple of people that this is the way that I would help gain weight if I kept track of my calories more. And I gave myself a goal of every day to have this many calories and everything. That was 20 years ago. At least 20 years ago.
I don't know if you did it, James. I don't know if you achieved that goal.
Yeah, it didn't happen. On average, Americans plan to eat Thanksgiving leftovers the most. Their calories are going to be the most.
Oh, okay.
An 8% plan to eat them for a week or more, their leftovers. Okay. Just as a side story.
I wouldn't eat them much past a week.
Unless you freeze them.
If you freeze them, you're good, but
I genuinely think, like, my dad loves family, loves being thankful for things. He's a big perspective guy, always has been. I genuinely think the only purpose for Thanksgiving for him is the leftovers. That's
they
it.
Are the best.
I'm telling you.
He loves a leftover turkey sandwich. Yep. That guy,
loaded up, you put everything on there,
Thanksgiving, he's good, he's cutting the turkey, he's a good guy and all that stuff. The day after, you'll see old smile on his face. Just happy, just eating that turkey sandwich.
Nice.
Well, the thing about Thanksgiving food is how many vegetables are the centerpiece of your Thanksgiving meal? Pretty much zero. And especially here in the Midwest, green beans kind of make an appearance in a green bean casserole,
right?
Which isn't really a vegetable. So that could be part of it.
Hey, man, down south, mac and cheese is a vegetable. So
that is not a vegetable,
well,
Seth.
I'm not saying it's
true. I don't care where
true.
You are in the country.
They call it a vegetable. I'm telling you, it is. Well,
other name.
Now, wait a minute, Melissa. You know, sweet potatoes and potatoes, those are technically vegetables.
Technically.
Yeah,
they're
so.
They're also full of carbs.
But they're also full of other nutrients, too. Don't badmouth a potato.
Bad-mouthing him. I love potatoes. I love all Thanksgiving foods. But I'm just saying, that's maybe why the calorie count is so high.
Probably. It's all the stuff they put in the potatoes and in sweet potatoes and the green bean casserole. It's all the extras. Yeah. Yep.
A little later in the 9 o'clock, we're going to talk about who you'd like to be sitting next to, what celebrity you would like to be sitting next to during that Thanksgiving meal, and what Americans are planning to eat during that Thanksgiving meal. We got those coming up for you a little bit later.
I'm going to hear the weird ones. Yeah. Like, you know, the people eat like pasta, you know, for things. What is that? Jeez.
How much it's going to cost is where we go next, though. And here's some welcome news. The American Farm Bureau says that your Thanksgiving dinner should cost a little less than it did back last year at this time.
Ooh, cool.
They crunch the numbers each year and look at around a dozen Thanksgiving staples like turkey, stuffing, pumpkin pie. And they've been doing this for over 40 years now. According to a report, a basic Thanksgiving meal for 10 people will cost an average of $58.08 or $5.81 per person if you are looking to charge your family members as they walk
just,
in the door.
Just in case. You know, that's right up.
That's down 5% from a year ago.
That's actually a really good deal.
That's bad.
$5 for a person? That's not bad.
That's a cheap meal.
Yeah.
And 5% down over there. So it's almost as if the inflation and things we were dealing with had nothing to do with politics, but more to do with a pandemic that happened and some other factors that happened.
A lot of other factors that happened, yeah.
And in fact, it was actually down, and our numbers are more correct to what they should be.
Mm-hmm. And our economy is doing well.
For almost a year now. That's fascinating. Wow. Because that's not what I was being told beaten over the head with over the last 4 months. That's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, American Farm Bureau. It's almost as if we've had this here for decades. This wonderful
all this great information, right?
Coming from the backbone of our country and our farmers. That's fascinating. It's still 19% more than the same meal cost pre-pandemic. Mm-hmm. But that is how inflation and that's how numbers work. That's how the economy works.
Yes.
But they say if you adjust for inflation, it's actually the second cheapest it's been since they started tracking these prices back in the mid-80s.
Wow. Now that is saying something.
And that's fascinating.
That's cool.
And there's a very important part of that sentence. If you adjust your inflation, if you adjust to today's standards, That's not hard for people to do. When we're talking about box office numbers and you're comparing Gone with the Wind with Forrest Gump, it takes people 1 second to be like, well, of course, it's different because
ticket prices were cheaper back then, right?
Prices have gone up. Yep.
Mm-hmm. But God help us when politics get involved and everything, then all of a sudden everybody wants to appoint somebody to blame. Somebody to blame. Yep. When guess what? 99% of things in life usually ain't somebody to blame. And if there is, they're dead. They're people to blame that were alive 50, right. 60 years ago five, six decades ago even and everything.
So much of it is how we've set up our the structural, how we set up our economy, how we set up all this stuff. Yeah, that's why we have these things that happen.
Turkey is the most expensive item on the shopping list. They say a 16-pounder going to cost you $25.
Okay. Makes sense.
Makes sense, yeah. They have a nice graph here that you can find. if you go to their website, you can find out more. I'll make sure to get that website out there before we wrap up. But their Thanksgiving dinner. So turkey, $25. Cranberries, 12-ounce, going to be $2.35. Sweet potatoes, $2.93. Why do I feel like I'm doing an episode of Let's Make a Deal? Yeah. You got to get
it's
close.
It's a supermarket sweep. Yeah, that's what we're doing. Yeah.
There we go.
Carrots and celery, about 84 cents. Green peas, $1.73. Nine pie shells, $3.40.
Nine.
$3.40. Dinner rolls.
You got to have all the different kinds.
Wow, that's a lot.
What? From you about pie?
I'm just shocked by it. Maybe I'm delirious. It's like, oh my God, nine pies. Oh my God.
I'm going to horrify you here, Seth. When I was younger, I actually got in trouble with my mom because we didn't have a ton of snacks in the house.
Mm-hmm.
And I love like pie crust. And I ate one of her pie crusts as a snack.
Oh.
Oh, dude.
There was like three of them. And I thought she had an extra or something like that. I didn't know that she was like, she had specifically planned like baking like five different pies. Right. And she was going to give them out as gifts and everything.
That's hilarious. Hey, man, when my mom used to make pies, she made her own dough. And if she had leftover dough, she would cut those into strips. And she'd put sugar and cinnamon on
elephant
them.
Elephant ears. Yep.
And then just bake it. Oh, they were good. Mm-hmm. God, oh, my God.
My mom did that, too.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, Mom. Way to drop the ball. Like, I could have just been eating those.
See, you just have those little extra pieces of pie crust.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The other thing to use extra pie crust for this year is the turkey or the Thanksgiving leftover pot pie.
Mm. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
People are leftovers in there mm-hmm. and you bake it. Yum.
That's good stuff.
I can still remember her reaction to this.
Of course you can.
It was Thanksgiving morning and it was one of those ones where you expect like fury and instead it's just, oh, very disappointed in you, James. Like when she'd call you James, it's not Jimmy.
She was exhausted.
James. Yes, yeah. It would almost have been better if she just yelled at you or something.
Say, and here is James devastated.
Yeah. Whole milk, $3, $3.21. Pumpkin pie mix, $4. So it is just giving you kind of the numbers here. They have dinner rolls here at $4.16. I will agree with that if they are the Hawaiian dinner rolls, if they are that. That is one item I could see myself like everything in the store. Well, we can get a cheaper version of this, mm-hmm. this, or whatever. Hawaiian rolls, $30,000. Okay. All right.
He's willing to pay premium for those Hawaiian rolls, man.
For those. I don't care. I don't know if it's even a meal without those. I'm not sure. They're good rolls. They're good rolls. We're going to keep rolling here. And we got the great 9 o'clock hour lined up for us. Beth Habhegger going to be in with us with the kitchens open. Looking mm-hmm. forward to that. That's going to be a fun segment. After that, we'll get into some entertainment news. We have to say goodbye to a game show legend. Want to talk a little bit about the director of Wicked and him talking about asking the fans for something. I will go over the box office numbers over the weekend a little bit, too. It was a pretty interesting weekend with the box office. I got all that coming up. Let you know what's new on your small screen. What is coming up on your local theater stage? And we've got to talk Rekindle the Spirit.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. That coming up as
awesomeness.
Well. A lot of fun stuff lined up for you coming up in the 9 o'clock hour, everybody. And I do want to remind everyone that we have a blood drive happening today in Wisconsin Rapids from 2 to 7 over at my old stomping grounds, the former East Junior High School cafeteria. Head mm-hmm. on over to 311 Lincoln Street today from 2 to 7 and be a hero.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I've said this before, and with the rise of the, still of superhero movies and everything. everything. There's a lot of people that think, well, in order to be a superhero, I need a cape, I need a tragic backstory, and I need a nickname. No, all you got to do is donate blood, and
that's
you are
need.
A superhero.
Super
that
easy.
That is it. And it is a lot easier, and you're not going to trip over your cape. You don't have to have a moody backstory.
You have it so long, man.
Yeah, it's a lot
keep
easier.
Keep that cape shorter.
Donate if you can today, everybody. 2 to 7 over at the former Eastern High School cafeteria over here in Wisconsin Rapids. I encourage you to do so. We'll be back with more show coming up on The Morning Show at WFHR.
This is Locally Grown.